السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. We always praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions. We ask Allah to bless them, to bless every one of us, and to grant us goodness. This evening I have a topic that many people don't like to talk about. People hear the topic and they run away. They don't want to talk about it. What do you think that topic is? Subhanallah. Something people don't like to hear. They always say, why do the scholars talk about this? Why do they make us go into this frenzy, etc., etc.? What do you think the topic is? Subhanallah. Let's hear something. Death. He knows it. Subhanallah, you are right. We are talking about death because in our community here in Bulawayo, we have lost several people in the recent past. May Allah give them Jannatul Firdaus. May Allah make it easy for their families as well. I want to discuss this topic from a totally different angle so that you don't need to worry, inshallah. Al-mawtu babun wa kullu an-nasi dakhiluhu. Death is a door that everyone shall go through. I'm sure you've heard me say this before. You've heard so many others perhaps say this before. There is no chance that you are not going to die. Zero chance. Zero chance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a good death. I want to start off by telling you something very interesting. You have iman, belief, conviction within your heart. You have nothing to fear. For as long as you are trying your best to please Allah. That's it. If you are trying your best to please Allah, what are you worried about? But when you know that you're not trying your best, when you know that you're actually very, very far out of line and you have no intention to come online, you have something to worry about, a concern. That worry is that the one who made you in the first place, if you don't have a relationship with him, how do you expect to have a beautiful future? How do you expect to go back to a lovely place, to the same one who made you, and hand in some embarrassing results for your examination? If you would be embarrassed to show your own father the results of an examination after that father has paid the school fees or the university fees for so long, and they've struggled to do that, and you were embarrassed to show them your result, it would only mean you know you did not do well. The example of Allah is far higher than that. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. When we speak about the examples we give regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are always on the highest level possible. But it's the same. You would be, and I would be, embarrassed to hand our deeds to Allah when we haven't tried. But I promise you, remember the three-letter word in English, T-R-Y. Try and keep trying and don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Don't you have iman? Haven't you said the shahada? Haven't you said ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna muhammadan rasulullah? Haven't you said that? If you have, surely you need to have hope. I promise you, I want to start off with this example. Before you were born and you were in the wombs of your mothers. In fact, I was speaking to a group of little children who come to the madrasa here, mashallah. And I was quite excited to talk to them, all bright children, our own children, mashallah. And I spoke to them for a long, long time this afternoon. And one of the things I was telling them was the same example. When you were in the wombs of your mothers, I'm going to word it a little bit differently because we are speaking to adults. What do you remember from there? Zero. Nothing. What do you remember from the womb of your mother? Anyone? Anyone remembers anything? Put up your hand, please. And really you would be a genius. Subhanallah. Your brain started operating in that way from there. But were you there or not? If you were not in the womb of your mother, put up your hand. All of us were there and none of us remember anything. Allahu Akbar. What does that show you about you and I? What does it show you? When Allah wants you not to remember something, you won't. People argue and fight about what's going to come after death. We're going to have Jannah. In Jannah, I don't want the same husband. I don't want the same wife. I want this car. I want that thing. Can you turn that off, Habibi? I have this and I have this and I want this and I want that. And we want all sorts of things. Subhanallah. You don't realize when you get to Jannah, you won't even remember. If Allah doesn't want you to remember the days of your dunya, and you may remember some of them, but the materialistic items, none of them. None of these things qualify to go to the other side. Let me explain. Between you and this world, when you were in the womb of your mother, was a small barrier. What was it? Membrane. The membrane of the womb and the skin of the belly of your mother. That's it. Perhaps the thickness of an inch or less than an inch, in fact. That was the membrane. On the other side of the membrane was real life. It was a small membrane, but for you inside, there is nothing besides this world that I'm in as a small little zygote that formed as a result of the gametes fusing within this womb of your mother. And you were a few little particles and small little a multiplication of cells that happened initially, and then the organs and the muscles began to grow, and you were excited swimming in the ocean from one side to the other and the third side to the fourth, until you grew a little bit older and you started kicking, and you were so happy. There must have been so many things, one wonders, perhaps a little bit of something you always liked. When your mother must have eaten something sweet, who knows, you must have been feeling the sweetness and you were very happy. Subhanallah. Thinking, if you knew that there was a life to come after this, I wish I have this same protein when I come on the other side. I hope it's going to be there. I hope really it's going to be there. You might have been wishing for things. And you know what? As a result, there was things you liked, things you didn't like. Perhaps a little sound that affected you, some that didn't. Subhanallah, what happened? As you grew, the place became smaller and smaller, narrower and narrower. Listen carefully, because I'm going to give you some beautiful example. Became narrower and narrower. What did you think? Perhaps you may have thought, that's the end. What's going to happen? We're doomed. That's how we talk about real death now. You're doomed. I'm doomed. Why? You're going to die. Imagine the discussion in the womb. You're doomed. If you were twins, two talking to each other, hey, you're doomed, I'm doomed. Salaam alaikum. We're going. What's going to happen? Well, we're out. That's it. End. Astaghfirullah. You didn't know that there's 1 centimeter or inch between you and a whole new life that you wouldn't have dreamt of. You didn't even know. But Allah knew. Allah told those on the other side already that, you know what? Inside here, that's where you were. You don't remember it. But we know you were there. And now, you know you were there as well. But you don't remember anything. Nothing. Zero. You don't remember a droplet. Nothing. Amazing. And now, suddenly you couldn't move anymore. As you're kicking a little bit, you can't even move. Nothing. And then what happens? That amnion fluid is suddenly boom, out, gone. And now you think it's over. And just as you think it's over, boom, you come out into the real world. Pop. Mashallah. What happened? The whole world that I had just 5 minutes ago becomes irrelevant. You started off with a cry. Your lungs came into play. Your eyes opened. For the first time, you're seeing something very different from what was inside there. You didn't dream in the wildest of your dreams, in the wildest of your dreams, that this existed. And what was it? Bulawayo General Hospital. MashaAllah. May Allah grant us ease. SubhanAllah. You came out, yes. And you know what? You suddenly heard the sounds, you suddenly felt, you saw, etc., etc. You felt the weather, the temperature, the warmth was gone. The warmth of the womb was gone, but you were in a different type of warmth. The proteins you used to wish for, just like how we wish for Lamborghinis in the year after, all of that, you can't remember the proteins. Can you remember anything you liked in the womb? Can you remember anything that got you happy and excited? Can you even have a fraction of a whiff of it? Nothing. Zero. And what happened? Suddenly you came into this world. Whoa, real life. SubhanAllah. Now life started and things happened and things were very, very different. And you then saw later on others being born in a similar way. And there came a time when you yourself became a father or a mother. It was amazing. Huge experience, beautiful experience. The mother thinks she's probably not going to survive. And the child, only Allah knows what happened to the child. Carried by Allah. I promise you, my beloved brothers and sisters, I swear by Allah, the barrier between us and the hereafter is even thinner than the 1 inch that was between the mother's womb and this life. It is a flash. It is a split second and you travel into the hereafter. You've seen it happening. People are in front of you and boom, where did he go? They are on the other side of the barrier. Remember this. What barrier? Same barrier like there was on this side here. That was of skin. This is of a different nature that only Allah knows. We will only be able to talk about it
on the other side in a different way. For now, Allah has told us already, we are lucky. We're living in this huge, I don't want to call it a womb, but we're living in this huge earth and we're waiting. When you get old, when you get invalid, when you can't move anymore, don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Never. Just like there was a pop initially and you came into something amazing, there will be another pop and you will go into something even more amazing, the eternal life. Have you believed in Allah? Then why are you fearing death? Death is something that is a gift for a believer. Why are you fearing it? Yes, you shouldn't harm yourself. You shouldn't kill yourself. Suicide is prohibited in Islam. Totally. But at the same time, when you are facing death, sickness, disease, don't become despondent. Don't despair. Wallahi, I promise you, the magicians at the time of Musa alayhi salam, we always say they only made one sajda before they were executed wholesale. That one sajda was enough for them to get to Jannah. Allah says that was enough. We wiped out their sins and we gave them paradise. How many sajdas did you do just now for Salatul Maghrib? I'll have to sit and count in the case of a lot of people. Subhanallah. Imagine if Allah has to accept one of those. We are successful. May Allah grant us goodness. Have you not put your head on the ground for your maker? Yes, you have. Have hope in Allah. He will forgive you. He will grant you goodness. Don't associate partners with Him. That's one thing. You must remember. Number two, keep trying to please Him. Whenever you faltered, go back. When you faltered again, go back. When you faltered the third time, go back. Whether it was the same sin repeated or a different sin becomes irrelevant. Just go back to Allah again. Just go back to Allah. Don't ever lose hope. How many of you have admonished your children and the little child comes back to you with the same smile 10 minutes later and you feel for them that sense of love? When you do that with Allah, there is a greater sense of love. When Allah has punished you for something, you know you've suffered, but it brings you to the house of Allah. Do you think that the softness of your heart can be received by Allah in a harsh way? No way. No chance. Allah will receive it in a better way than you would had your own child come back to you with a smile after they broke 10 glasses all in a row or damaged your vehicle. May Allah grant us protection. Have hope in the mercy of Allah. Who do you think Allah is? Do you really think Allah gets joy by punishing you and I? مَا يَفْعَلُ اللَّهُ بِعَذَابِكُمْ إِن شَكَرْتُمْ وَآمَنْتُمْ. What is Allah going to get by punishing you if you are thankful people and if you believe in Allah? Allah's not going to punish you. So let's get this idea out of our heads that Allah is looking for reason to punish. Rather, the truth of the matter is Allah is looking for reason to forgive. Allah is looking for reason to have mercy. Don't lose hope. We are believers. People talk of death and they only talk of how it's going to be doomed and how there are scorpions in the grave and snakes that are going to come and you will be struggling and you will suffer and it's going to be hot and the flame of Jahannam is going to be burning such that in the masjid sitting in the house of Allah, we already start sweating because of that heat. Allahu Akbar. Yes, while there is the punishment of Allah that we do talk about, today we are in desperate need to talk about the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People have lost hope because they don't remember the mercy of Allah. Allah is Rahman, Rahim, Wadud, Ghaffar, Subhanallah, Halim. Allah is the most forgiving, the most loving, the most kind, the most beneficent, the most compassionate. The one who often forgives. That is Allah. The most loving, Allah. The most loving? Have you thought of the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. May Allah grant us goodness. So death will come indeed. Prepare for it. By doing what? Two things. Taqwallahi wa husnul khuluqi. I promise you, those two things will get you into Jannah. They will get you into paradise. Look at your relationship with Allah and improve it every day. Look at your relationship with the rest of the creatures of Allah. I tell you what, in this masjid right now, check some of the faces. All these faces. Different colors, different races, different people, different financial levels, different standing. Every one of you is very, very special to Allah. You are a VIP. Don't ever let anyone make you believe that he is more important than you in the eyes of Allah. No. No. You're a VIP. You are. And if I believe that you too have the same Allah as me, automatically I have worshipped Allah. How? I'm acknowledging His greatness and His vastness and the fact that the closeness to Allah actually comes Irrelevant of your color, your financial standing, your this, your that. That's irrelevant. Allah never looks at your money. He never looks at your skin. He never looks at the shape of your body. Inna Allah ta'ala la yanzuru ila suwarikum wa la ila ajsamikum. Allah doesn't look at your shape and design, your body. He doesn't look at all of that. Walakin yanzuru ila qulubikum wa a'malikum. Allah is interested in looking at the heart and your deeds. Slice anyone, you will find the blood. What color is it? What color is it? Thank you. It is red. Take out the heart of anyone. What color is it? Subhanallah Rabbil Alameen. Allah shows you mankind. I have created different colors, different sizes, different shapes, different people, different financial levels. In order to test all of you, to see, do you mock them? Do you respect them? Do you use what I gave you on others who don't have what you have? Do you come closer to Allah? Do you distance yourself from Allah? Do you become arrogant and proud? Do you not become arrogant and proud? Does it humble you when we give you? Does it actually bring you closer to us? Or does it distance you? Do you become very, very haughty just because Allah has blessed you in a way that He hasn't blessed other people, etc., etc., etc.? All of this is part of the test of Allah. Did you choose what color you want to be? No, Allah chose. So Allah tells you, just remember, you are on earth for us to test you. It's a huge school that you have entered. Once you are in it, you will be tested one after the other, a third, a fourth. I have people who tell me, you know, I think Allah forgot me. Astaghfirullah. Don't ever think like that. Allah didn't forget you. وَمَا مِن دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا وَيَعْلَمُ مُسْتَقَرَّهَا وَمُسْتَوْدَعَهَا كُلٌّ فِي كِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ. There is nothing ever that moves on earth except that Allah has taken it upon Himself to provide for it. Nothing that moves, the ants, the fleas, the ticks, these little items, Allah says, we have taken it upon ourselves to provide. Necessity, we will give. Subhanallah. Who feeds the fleas and the ticks, the mosquitoes? Allah, even if that sustenance is written with your blood, but Allah gave the mosquito the opportunity to quickly get into the room. They are now sophisticated. Before, we used to spray doom and the mosquitoes were gone. Now you spray it, it's like they have a university of their own where they must be wearing some form of jackets that have this anti-doom sort of a suit that they have. You spray how much you want and they still come to your ear at night. What's going on? When I was young, they told us a fly can never fly backwards. It always flies to the front. We used to catch the flies by getting to the front and moving our hand quite quickly. The fly was in your hand 9 times out of 10. Now, they've learned how to fly backwards. Why? I'm sure they must have evolved. Just like humankind, there are things we do now we didn't used to do before. I'm sure it's the same with other creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I saw a fly not too long ago. I tried to take it from the front and I saw it flying in reverse. I said, whoa, this must be from Zimbabwe. May Allah grant us ease. Allah grant us ease. So, my beloved brothers, you need to remember, if Allah looks after an ant and a flea, 1 billion ants can fit on your body. Do you agree? Do you think He hasn't noticed you? Do you think He doesn't know about you? So someone tells me, Allah has forgotten me because I have one problem after another, after another, after another, and it just doesn't end. When one issue is coming to an end, another one starts. I mentioned this slightly in Jumu'ah. But let me explain. That's not it. When you're at school and you have exam after exam after exam, they say, what a good school, mashallah. My son goes to a private school. Lovely, they give exams every week. There's a weekly exam. And then you go to another school and the exam comes once a year and the children are lazy throughout the year. What will happen? They might fail. When Allah loves you, He gives you more and more tests. He says that with the lips of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, inna Allah idha ahabba 'abdan ibtalahu. When Allah loves someone, He puts more examinations. Why? The certificate you're going to get is way beyond the certificate of other people. So embrace the test. Embrace it. It's a challenge. I always say, oh Allah, if this is the test you tested me with, I thank you. It's okay, I'm going to go through it. You didn't take my limbs away, you didn't take my eyes away, you didn't take my hearing away, you didn't test me with something that really is a major, major, major disaster. I know of someone who lost their spouse recently with two or three little kids. They sent an email to me saying, you know what, I really don't want to live anymore. I said, you have to live. You have to keep going. You have to understand the plan of Allah. You have children. You have to be there for your children. You have to understand Allah will take people away. He promised you. That's what life is all about. Have hope. They have gone to a good place. You make sure you don't lose out. You also need to go to a good place. When a football match is going on, you and I know the matches that are happening now, right or wrong. Okay, let's not get into that topic. But anyway, when a football match is going on and the referee pulls out a red card for your favorite player, your heart sinks. Has the match come to an end yet? Maybe one player is gone, but we're still going to play. We might be losing. Without that player, we can still win if we keep on playing well. But if you decide, hey, one player is gone, that's it, let's close the match, you will lose without a doubt. The same thing applies in a different way. When Allah took one person away from your family, keep going so that all of you get Jannah. When you celebrate, that person will be there celebrating with you that all of us are in Jannah together. When the team wins, the one with the red card who was sitting on the bench will come onto the pitch to celebrate with the trophy, even though they had a red card. You've seen it happening. I've seen it happening. They left earlier. One or two players are gone. It will happen. Before me, some of my family members will go. Does it mean I must say, right, Allah forgot me. I'm sitting. I don't want to live anymore. I must also die. For what? It's like saying, okay, referee, it's 45 minutes only into the game. We're not playing anymore. Give it to the other team because you know what? One guy is out. Now we're all out. Why? You understand that about football, the example of life is way beyond the example of football. Silly example that I've given you, but perhaps it might make things a little bit more understandable. Don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Never, never. I want to tell you, there is a sickness and a disease we have in our societies and communities. We never read the Quran, we never read Salah at times. We never do good, we never drill boreholes in our lives. We never print matters, we never learn, we never teach others. These are all sadaqa jariyas. When we die, we expect others to do it for us. And those who are doing it for us have never done it for themselves either. People never read Quran for themselves. But when a person dies, they say, oh, hang on, that guy died. Let's all read Quran for him. But my brother, what about you in your life? What did you do? What guarantee do you have that your deed is acceptable for yourself, that you want to take it and give it to someone else when you don't even know that Allah's taken it from you and you haven't even done it for you and you want to take it and give it to them? Subhanallah. So what I want to encourage you to do is read Quran for yourself. One khatam every month. Are you ready to do it? When you die, no one will need to read Quran for you. Never. They don't need to. They don't have to. The most powerful thing ever to do for someone who died is the simplest thing. Do you know what it is? Without a doubt, nothing more powerful than just raising your hands and making dua for them. Oh Allah, forgive them. Oh Allah, grant them Jannah. That's it. Did you ever know that? Nothing more powerful than dua. Nothing. Zero. There are certain things we do that are questionable, doubtful, argued in the ummah as to whether it's even allowed or not, but we are quick to do it. But when something is there without a doubt in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, we feel this is too light to do. Allah says, hang on, I know it's someone else. You don't have to do a big deal for them. Do a big deal for yourself. Amazing, amazing. How many of us have drilled boreholes in our own names? Almost zero. I promise you. Maybe a few. How many of us, subhanallah, have done things, our own salah is not in order. So what happens? We never end up doing acts of worship for ourselves. Never. Because everything that was done for a dead person. Someone, if you ask him, how much Quran did you read? When last did you read Quran? He says, oh, you know, when that uncle died, I read the Quran. Oh. What do you mean? He says, hey, you know, we were sitting, we had to do the Quran. Okay, so thank you. You were sitting, you had to do it, you did it. What you did it for, how you did it, etc., etc. All that is a topic we can talk about for 2 hours. But did you ever read Quran for yourself? Did you improve your recitation of the Quran? It's the word of Allah. It's your connection. It's your link. It's the fuse between this current and the other current that's coming together. Link it and you'll get Jannah. You don't need to worry. The point I'm raising, don't get stressed. Make an effort. Make an effort. Do something for yourself. Print, publish. You don't have to say whose name. You benefit some people. Learn, teach. A few words to someone. Benefit. I was sitting yesterday and I delivered a lecture. It was the day before yesterday. I decided that I'm going to let this lecture beam live on Instagram. And one or two people were trying to tell me, don't. I said, I will do it whether you like it or you don't like it. Because I want Jannah. Well, I'm going to sit in the masjid. There will be 20 people, 30 people. I'm happy. I don't mind talking to two people. But if I can't talk to 10,000 at one time, why shouldn't I? For what? I'm going to reach 10,000 people who never go to the masjid sometimes. I'm going to reach them. I will do it. I don't care what you think. It's my relationship with Allah. It's my building of my own akhirah. I don't need you to read one sentence of the Quran when I die for me. I just need you to make dua for me. I don't need you to drill a well for me. Nothing. We don't want it. We are doing it while we are alive. We ask Allah to accept it from us. That's now speaking the language of the Prophet ﷺ. What have you done for yourself? Ya Aisha, i'mali fa inni la ughni anki min Allahi shay'an. The Prophet ﷺ says, O Aisha, you are my daughter. Do your deeds. I'm not going to be able to assist you against Allah's decision in any way. Although Nabi ﷺ has shafa'ah, he has the intercession, he's the best of creation, and definitely he is able and capable to help if Allah wills. But what he means is, if Allah has written that it's not going to happen, it won't happen. That's what he means. So what has it got to do with your deeds? Worry about it yourself. Don't let others con you into minimizing your deeds. No. Subhanallah. I just gave you one example of my own little life. We are nowhere near what we are supposed to be doing, but we have to keep trying. If you have tried, you will succeed. So I spoke about two things. Taqwallahi wa husnul khuluq. As for taqwallah, I said, it means develop your relationship with Allah. I used to say, taqwallah refers to the consciousness of Allah. It's part of it. I used to say, the fear of Allah. It's part of it. We used to say, creating the barrier between you and the punishment of Allah. It's part of it. But I've now found the best way to interpret the term taqwallah is the relationship with Allah. Develop the relationship with Allah. Everything to do with a positive relationship with Allah is part of your taqwa. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu taqullah. So many times in the Quran. O you who believe, develop your relationship with Allah. Secondly, develop your relationship with others who Allah created. The same Allah made. The man you don't like on the other side of the street, Allah made him. He's also important to Allah. He might be in Jannah before you. He might be a VIP. Today someone was asking me, I have a problem in my home. I said, maybe there is a slight chance that someone important in the eyes of Allah has made a dua against you if you did wrong to them. There's a chance. Sometimes we suffer as the result of a bad deed we did to someone. When someone says, oh Allah, destroy this person, it's not such a good dua for us to make. But some people in their frustration, they force to make it because we keep on pecking at them, keep on harming them, keep on not wanting good for them. Why? Are you successful? A sign of success is to ask yourself, how many others have I built to the similar level of success, if not more? The failure of the ummah is those who are at the top do not want to see others come to the top like them. That's the failure of the ummah. Whether it's in the masjid, whether it's out in the business, no matter where it is. If you are sitting in a top position, if you have a massive business, a massive wholesale, and you're worried about a tuck shop outside in the pavement, the other side, you have no iman. People want to extinguish a tuck shop. But brother, you are making 100 million, man. That guy's not going to make $100. In fact, his tuck shop stuff he gets from you. Subhanallah. Why? Why? I always look at these things and I tell myself, subhanallah, as a leader, how many others have you built to your level or more? As a businessman, how many others have you seen grow? That is what will help you on the other side of the little barrier that you and I could get to at any time. With birth, we all know it's 9 months approximately. Seldom you have some premature births. May Allah make it easy for all our women folk. MashaAllah. Those who are about to deliver, those who are expecting, may Allah make it easy for them. Ameen. And those who don't have children, may Allah make it easy for them too. Ameen. We know it's approximately that time, so we're expecting it and we see. But with death, we don't know when it's going to be. It can take you at any time. It doesn't know an age, right? Today I want to tell you, do your deeds and have hope in the mercy of Allah. Don't have a false hope. You know what's a false hope? Drinking, alcohol, drugs, gambling, adultery, pornography. Then we're hoping Allah's going to have mercy on us. Don't worry, we heard in the masjid that on the other side we get what we want. Astaghfirullah. Without a joke, I had a young man come to me and say, I want to ask you a question. I want to change my life, but I want to know, if I give up weed for the sake of Allah here, is it going to be in Jannah? I asked him, are you high? What a question. What a question. Have you ever thought of it? A man is saying, I'm ready to give up something, but I want to know if it's the other side. You know what the true answer is? My beloved brother, my beloved sister, my child, my daughter, my son, let me tell you, forget about what's in Jannah. Work towards getting into it yourself. When once you get there, you will never ever regret. Never. Allah promises you, He will make you happy. Everything that you want, you'll have it. But you first need to go there to check what's on display. Because you know what? You can't think with the brain here what you want on the other side of the barrier. Just like you couldn't think in your womb what you're going to want on the other side, because you don't even know what the other side is all about. Besides what you've been told in Revelation. So I want to tell you, my brothers, when you read Quran, every letter has 10 rewards. Smile. Thank Allah. Spend a few more moments. People spend time in the gym. People spend time in the gym. And I'm encouraging it. It's good. If you spend time in a well-equipped gym that is compliant to our norms, it is encouraged. You need to keep fit by the will of Allah. But you will sweat, you will toil, you will run, you will jump, you will do the squats, you will do the burpees, you will do weights, you will do whatever else, you do the rowing, you do everything in order to look a little bit better. The body that perhaps might have one small mechanical, technical, electrical problem, and suddenly you are no more with the 12 pack that you had and you're lying dead. Yes, 12 pack. Each one of the six is divided into two because of how much training you were doing. I'm not saying it's bad, but I'm saying with that, Allah will still take you away. However, to look good and to feel a little bit good, you went into the gym. MashaAllah, I hope you feel good and I hope you look good, MashaAllah. But the question I have is, if you are ready to make such a great effort in order to just achieve a little bit for this world, can't you make a small effort to read a bit of Quran, to talk to people with respect? One thing I must say, cut out bad words. I promise you. I'm not just speaking to the young. Some of the adults know more words than some of the youngsters. Bad words. Cut out bad words. I challenge you tonight. This afternoon I spoke about greeting. That was my challenge. Tonight, I want you to take home one thing. Cut out bad words and increase the praise of Allah from your lips. Something bad happens, instead of saying SH, whatever else the people say, say, Astaghfirullah. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Is it difficult? Do that. It will help you on the other side of the barrier. Vulgar words make you cheap even in the eyes of Allah. Respect yourself by saying that which is respectful. Trust me, it requires a little bit of training and effort, and within a month you will forget all those words. It will become nature. You won't say bad words. But with us, every small thing is a bad word. When something good happens, you have to utter a big bad word. I think it's the culture that's overtaking the globe. Something very nice happened and you say, oh, F, look at this car. Astaghfirullah. For what? Why did you have to say that? Couldn't you say, Ya Allah, look at this car? Couldn't you say, Ya Ilahi, look at this? Allahu Akbar. At least you named Allah. You called out to Allah. But no. I said it bluntly, right? Because that's what happens. It's a fact. We don't want to lie to you. We all know what I'm talking about. So let's change our tongues. I tell you why. When death comes to you at that moment, if it were to come with a sudden bang, do you want to die saying whatever F word there was? Or do you want to die with a better word, La ilaha illallah, or even Allah? Imagine a big bang happens and you say, La ilaha illallah, because you're used to it. What will happen? It's your last word. Suddenly the wall came crashing, you all disappeared. But if you used to F and B and whatever else, it goes up to Z nowadays. Whatever other word you're saying, and you used to it so much, what do you want on the other side? Your last word was, oh, astaghfirullah. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. And then you go to the other side. Is it fair? Is it good? Is it something you want? Well then change. You're a believer in Allah. It must show on your tongue. Respect people, even those you disagree with. Respect them. Speak to them. Greet them nicely. What are you losing? It shows your relationship with Allah. You know, those who call you kafir, fasiq, fajir, whatever else, trust me, you must keep on saying words of respect even to them. It doesn't cost you anything. Nothing. It's an honor, subhanallah, to be respectful. Those who don't like you, those who doom you, those who swear you, those who curse you, those who want to harm you, respectfully defend yourself. With respect, defend yourself. But don't be cheap. Your character is what will take you to Jannah, I promise you. It's the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. He says, blessed are those with great character. He told the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, those in paradise will be those who have great character. Allah says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. As for you, O Muhammad ﷺ, you are on that highest level of character and conduct. Wow. Subhanallah. Why do you think, and I'll end on this point inshallah, why do you think Allah gave Jannah to those who were kind to the dogs and the cats, etc., and He punished those who were unkind to the kittens and the cats? There are stories in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Because when you are kind to a dog and a pig you're not allowed to eat, dog you're not allowed to eat, right? When you're kind to a dog and a pig, it shows that you recognize the one who made me made the dog. The common factor is life here was given by the same maker to me and to this creature. Why must I harm it? For what? Why must I harm it? It doesn't mean pig is haram, so you must throw stones at the pig. No. Astaghfirullah. You don't. We won't eat it. We won't perhaps go near it, etc., etc. But leave it. Let it be. If culling is needed, it shall be done. But even that, in a respectful way. إِذَا قَتَلْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُوا الْقِتْلَةَ وَإِذَا ذَبَحْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُوا الذِّبْحَةَ. When you are slaughtering an animal, you need to do it with ihsan, with kindness, the most kindness. In Islam, there are rules that fill a whole book regarding how an animal should be treated. Subhanallah. What about human beings? And we look at Joe from down the road. I hope there's no one called Joe here. But anyway, okay, maybe there is. Let's choose another name. You know, we look at Tom from down the road, subhanallah, I don't think there's a Tom at all. And we start thinking to ourselves, you know, this guy here, look at this guy. And we start saying bad words and we don't want to this. Come on, be respectful. Be respectful. You know what? Allah has created the brain. And Allah made every single brain different. Every brain is different. Your level of understanding, Dr. Ashmawi's level of understanding, Brother Khalil's level of understanding, Ismail Jasset's level of understanding, my level of understanding, Uncle Yusuf's level of understanding, all these levels are different, very different. We're not going to be thinking or comprehending or understanding or interpreting things on exactly the same level. It's different. Who made it? Allah made it. My challenge in life is how am I going to keep on getting along with all these people with the difference in understanding? Have you thought of it? Difference in understanding. It cannot be my way all the time. That's it, me. No, think about it. Think carefully. Look at these people, respect them, discuss with them, talk to them, convince them. That is your reward. If Allah wanted, He didn't need to keep something known as da'wah or propagation. He didn't need it. He could have dropped that guidance straight from the heaven into the brain of a person or the heart of a person. He could have done it. But Allah says, we want you to talk to each other. When you talk to them and you convince them to do what is right, we'll give you a reward, full reward. And if they were to convince a third person, you as the grandfather of the idea will get a reward also. And the great-grandfather of the idea or the effort will get a reward. Subhanallah. Amazing. That's Allah's plan. Do good. My brothers and sisters, pack up as much good as you can. I give you another example of football. I know I said I ended on that point, but we had extra time. Don't worry. Football, what happens? You have a certain fixed time. Right? When you start, whistle is blown, and you start. What's your job? What's your job as a footballer? You need to try and score. That's it. Any other job? No. How many goals? No limit. The more the merrier. We'll break a record. I saw once someone beat another team 52-0. I was like, what? But don't worry, they were playing for butter and beans, as we say. 52-0. What happens? You break a world record. I don't mind. If I score 1, 2, 3, I'm not going to stop. 4, 5, 6. I keep on going. Every minute I'll go. I'll be a champion, right? Your job is to keep scoring goals until when? The whistle is blown again. When its whistle is blown, you start counting. Right, who's the winner? This guy, etc. Life is just like that. Your whistle was blown at the point of puberty and maturity where you start doing your deeds. Pack away one deed, two deed, three deed, four deed. The Prophet ﷺ sat with his companions one day. He said, who gave a charity? Abu Bakr said, I. Who visited a sick person? I. Who did this? I. Who did this? I. Everything Abu Bakr said, I. Imagine with us, how many of you visited a sick person? Very few. How many of you did this? Very few. I can do better. Myself, I can do better. I must pack away every day. I've got a short time. Score 20 goals and then the day is over. You thank Allah. Oh Allah, thank you for giving me this day. Tomorrow morning is a new day. I started either with tahajjud or with fajr, but there's no third option. Right? And then the second day I do good deeds, good deeds. Even if you're at work. For example, you have a business, you have a surgery, you have for any other type of business. So you charge people, etc. But you're good character, you speak to them, or you don't rip them off, or you treat them well, or you might want to give someone a discount, maybe if you feel that this person is deserving of it, or you might want to waive something and just tell them, don't worry, it's okay. You did your good deed for the day. You did another good deed for the day. One of the best deeds you can ever have in terms of interaction with people is a good expression on your face. Good expression on your face. Subhanallah. Just put a good expression on your face. Try. A little bit of a smile. People will look at you and they already see the energy coming from your face. Because you have a good expression. But when you look gloomy and doomed, and you just have the eyes that look like owls on the side, and you're just giving people those dirty little, you know, arrows, what will happen? Even the kind-hearted and even a good situation and happy people will all become silent in your presence because they look at the violent eyes that you have. Allah grant us ease. Say expression. All this is preparation for Jannah. Now when you have helped yourself, improved yourself, refined yourself, I'm a better person, I think good of others. That is another very, very interesting quality that we lack. Think good of others. Look at someone and love them. Alhamdulillah. Never mind, they made one mistake, two. It's okay, forget. Yeah, it does not mean you should allow abuse. Remember this. When we talk about being good and kind, I'm not at all encouraging you to allow and to promote or to just turn a blind eye to abuse, to aggression, to oppression. That is a different topic. I told you, when you deal with all of that, deal with it, but with respect. But I'm talking of generally, you see someone, a lot of the times we say things that we really, really don't need to talk about. It doesn't involve us at all. You know, today there is a syndrome. What's it? The breaking news syndrome. We all have WhatsApp, right? I think all of us. Some of us have more than one. Okay. Every one of us, to a certain level, we would love to be the first person to tell everyone about something juicy. It's a syndrome. Go back and think of what I said. It's a disease. If something happened, you want to quickly take a photo and say, I'm going to show the world. This time, I checked it first. Boom, you send it to all your friends. When someone sends it back to you, you know what you're sending it back to me for? It was me who actually saw this thing happening. Why? It's the one-upmanship, that disease that we face. Can I tell you what? The winner is the one who didn't even forward it to anyone. They just left it and made dua to Allah. Unless it concerned you or the people and they needed to know. A lot of what floats around is fake. On WhatsApp, they tell you about the situation in Zimbabwe. Can I inform you? 90% of the messages are all just made up to scare you and I, or to tell you and I things that are so negative that we become depressed. Yet, subhanallah, go out and see. May Allah grant us ease and goodness. We are facing challenges, but sometimes people love to add their sixpence and to add their flavorings and to make it the hot piri piri spice in order that everyone can actually take it. Did you hear the latest? Check what happened. Did you hear the latest? And that is a lie. It's a false item. It's sometimes a tale. We don't know how to tell the difference sometimes between the truth and false because there's so much of false. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. I think my overtime has now been taken. And may Allah open our doors. The main aim for what I said tonight, to make dua for those who've passed on, definitely. To do a'mal ourselves in our lives. That will help us the most. To keep trying in our relationship with Allah. To keep improving ourselves in our relationship with others. You want to know who you are. Look at your enemies and how you treat them and how your heart is about them. You'll be able to know who you are. Look at those who are considered insignificant in worldly life. Check how you treat them. A person who's cleaning the street, do you have a moment to greet him and to smile at him and to make him feel, wow, hey, someone acknowledged me. Someone noticed me. Subhanallah. If that's the case, you are refined. May Allah grant us that refining. Allah, open our doors. I promise you, if you have these deeds, you don't have to worry. Your relationship with Allah, in order. Relationship with others, improving. Always seeking forgiveness of Allah. The day you go with a smile. Even if you go at the age of 25, you go with a smile. And you will be in the happiest place. While people are crying about you, left behind in the world, you, on the other side of that little barrier we spoke about, are actually smiling, so happy, so excited, thanking Allah for all goodness. May Allah make us from those. May Allah grant us ease the day that we are facing our own death. May Allah give us a good death. May Allah grant us hope in His mercy. It is far more required in today's world than anything else. And yes, we are not negating, we are not denying that the punishment does exist, the wrath does exist, but give Allah reason to grant you His mercy. He will give it to you. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد سبحان الله بحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك.